This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today, I would like to welcome Arena Scott back to Dreamland. She was here just a few months ago in July of 2021. She's been on Dreamland before. And the reason she's come back so suddenly, so soon, usually we have a guest maybe once or twice a year, is she rocked me to my core with her new book, Beyond Pascagoula, The Rest of the Amazing Story. And boy, I'm telling you, there is quite a rest of the story. Just to recap briefly, on October the 11th, 1973, Calvin Parker and Charles Hickson were abducted while fishing at night near an abandoned shipyard. It was only the second big abduction case that was publicly known at the time. Now, let me tell you a little bit about Irina before we go on. She received her PhD from the University of Missouri. She did postdoctoral research at Cornell. She has been a professor, assistant professor at Bonaventure University, and has been at the Battelle Memorial Institute. And she is a highly accomplished researcher, obviously, and scholar. Irina, I would like to welcome you back to Dreamland again.
Well, I'm certainly glad to be here, and I think all your podcasts are great.
Well, thanks. Thanks very much. And I think your work is great. I think it's extraordinary. And I have to admit, this knocked my socks off. Beyond Pascagoula reminded me a bit of another event. And we'll get into this in just a minute, folks. Back in 1952, there was the flyover in Washington of a big UFO flyover and a UFO wave. That it also involved not an abduction, but an apparent landing of an entity in a little town called Flatwoods, West Virginia, that became known as the Flatwoods Monster Case. Now, we're talking here about UFO flaps, as they were identified by the Air Force back in the early 50s when they started to happen, where a whole wave of events happens. So, but before we go there, Irina, can you briefly remind us of what happened to Parker and Hicks?
Well, they were just two normal people. They weren't UFO people or anything like that. If you said UFO to them before this happened, they'd have probably laughed. But Hickson was an older man, about 45, and Calvin Parker was very young, a teenager. And they were family friends. I mean, Hickson was friends with Calvin's father and vice versa. So they'd been family friends for a long time. And they were working, and after the day of work, they decided to go fishing. Which in that type of area, by, you know, the Gulf of Mexico and the river, was what people did. And they went to several places fishing and didn't find anything good. And so they went to this other place by a pier. And the there was a sign there that said, no trespassing, I think. And it was Calvin's car, and he was young, and he was kind of worried about parking there. And he told Charles that if they got in trouble with the police, that he could go to jail and not him. So anyway, they went and started fishing. And then they saw a blue light. And they were both worried at first about that this might be the police, and especially Calvin, who had a new car, and told Hickson that he could go to jail, not him. But it turned out to be a whole lot worse than, excuse me, a whole lot worse than police because it was this object that was fairly big. I think they described it as 30 feet long or something, and floating. It wasn't on the ground, and it came, and real fast, it opened something. It appeared to open the door or something like that happened, and a real bright light came out of it. And then these three things, and he thought they were both of them seemed to think they were kind of like mechanical things, but two grabbed the older man and one grabbed the younger man, and they took him inside. And after they took him inside, they didn't see each other. And Calvin said that walked down someplace and that the light was real bright inside. And they walked down someplace and turned a corner and went into a room. And then there was this, he called it a glass table. I don't know if he could really see it or not, but he said they put him on it at about a 45 degree. And this thing came out of the wall and circled around him. It was like a cell phone today or something. And they both were back. When this was happening, when the things grabbed them, they were both absolutely terrified. And then it was like they got a shot or something. And he thought he got a shot. And he went from absolute total terror to being so relaxed he just didn't care what was going on, except for being terrified. And he couldn't move except that he could move his eyes and he was conscious. And so the things put him back where they started from. And I guess Calvin was just standing there with his arms up in the air like that, just stiff. And Charles, being older, tried to get him out of whatever he was in. And I think they both fell down or something. So anyway, at first they said, well, we're not going to tell anybody because obviously who would believe him? I mean, he said, well, I was abducted by a UFO. Nobody's going to believe you. And especially, yeah.
I'm sorry, I'm new at using this. I suddenly hit the wrong button. But I was just going to comment that that's still true. Nothing has changed there. So they were right to be frightened of that and to be wary of it. And then what happened to them when they did report it?
Well, then they tried to report it. And I think, first of all, they went to a newspaper and it was closed. And they called the Air Force Base. The Air Force Base told them that they don't collect UFO information, that Project Blue Book closed and everything. And so they, the Air Force told them to contact local authorities. So they called the police. And Calvin wasn't in favor of doing that at all, but Hickson was. And so Hickson called and said, you won't believe me, but we were abducted. And this, I talked to other police that had been around in the area at that time. And one of them said, this is a police bulletin went out and said, well, two drunks had been picked up and they were saying they'd been abducted. But however, the police took them kind of seriously. And especially because Calvin was crying in the background, and told him to come into the police station. So they separated him and put him in two different rooms and interviewed him separately, which is an intelligent thing to do, instead of just laughing at him. And then they put him together in a room with somebody that questioned them together. And then the man that was questioning left the room. And left them together. Well, what they didn't know was that the police had stuck a tape recorder hidden in the room, and the police were going to see if, you know, to see if they were honest or hoaxing. And they found out that they were honest. The two men were just terrified, and it definitely showed on the tape that, you know, they were just in this clipped. It wasn't like anything you'd rehearse or anything. It was just this clipped talk about how terrified they were and what had happened and what was going on. And I think Calvin said he thought he died and all kinds of things. And so after that, they had a lot more credibility with the police. The hard-nosed police actually believed them. And so it was reported immediately and investigated immediately, which is pretty odd for an abduction, because lots of people don't even want to think about it for years later. But Hickson was kind of smart in that area, because he thought it should be reported, and he'd been through life and death situations in the Army and stuff, and did report it. So it was investigated immediately by scientists and things that came out and talked to him. So there was a good credibility.
So there was a high level of credibility associated with the case. And one of the things that was actually unusual about the case was that they were tranquilized. Because, I mean, I had that happened to me, and I certainly wasn't tranquilized at all. And so that was quite a different thing. And for some whatever reason, it wasn't done. It hasn't been done very often. Now, Calvin Parker will be on Dreamland this year. I have been remiss in not having him on the show. So we're going to talk to Calvin later in more detail about his experiences. But now what I want to do is to talk a little bit about the UFO wave of 1973. As I said earlier, it's connected in some way to the wave of 1952. I have some secret knowledge about it, but that the two things have a structural a similarity. But tell us about, just in general, what started to happen in 1973.
Well, Project Blue Book had been going on and its predecessors had been going on since about 1947. I mean, there's Project Sign, Project Grudge, and Project Blue Book, collecting data. This was a government Air Force data collection, and people knew about it, so that if people thought they saw a UFO, they knew where to report it. And so from that data, which was all basically the same data and the same type of reports, they could tell if there was a wave. And a wave was when there was just be a sudden increase in UFO sightings and things related to UFOs that sort of go up and then down. And there's been studies of them where it's not, I mean, you think it'd be caused by publicity and things like that, but actually when some of the big movies and things came out, there wasn't any particular wave. But the government studies went from about 1947 to 1969. And due to the consistent data, you could tell if there was a sudden increase or decrease in UFO activity or reports. And it definitely showed peaks and troughs like that. But after 69, there wasn't a consistent way to get data. But even so, in 1973, there was such a huge wave of UFOs that this was considered another wave or flap, and it might have been the largest one of all. And it was very huge. There were all kinds of reports of everything you could imagine with UFOs and humanoids and sightings, and it was sort of unusual for several reasons. One was is that there seemed to be a lot of interaction, such as UFOs would, you know, if somebody shone a light on them, they might interact or move up and down or something, and that sort of thing. And there was a lot of interaction with human authority, such as police and airplane pilots and stuff. It was a huge, massive flap, even though it was later than the data collection. After that, there weren't any, if there were flaps, they didn't show up, because after that, Blue Book closed, and if anybody saw a UFO, they didn't know where to report it to. A lot of people probably didn't report. And if they did, they went to all kinds of places, so there wasn't a consistent way to see if there was a flap, except in 73 it was so extreme that it was like this 1952 one.
Right, and because of the closing of Blue Book and the lack of any organized reporting system, we were essentially blinded. We weren't able to tell exactly what was going on. But there were some extraordinary incidents then. And when we come back, Free Dreamlanders, we'll be talking about some things that you're not going to soon forget, believe me.
UnknownCountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe, in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind, as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future.
There was something that happened that summer, a huge sonic boom that in the book you describe is possibly the second loudest sound that's ever been heard on Earth. Can you tell us a little bit about that event and that sonic boom and where it was heard?
Yes, I got into the Pascagoula event for two reasons. One was I'd published books with Philip Mantle and Flying Disc Press, and people were coming out, and now after UFOs became sort of respectable, more or less, compared to the way they used to be, and talking about, there were other witnesses around the Pascagoula event, and he wanted me to interview people because he's in England with an accent, and people in Pascagoula have an accent too. I mean, you know, of course I do too to everybody else, but he wants somebody, an American, to interview him. And I could record what they were saying and everything. But another reason I was in it was because way, way back in when I was in Missouri in school, my mother was in Ohio, and she had called me and said, "Did you hear that noise?" And I told her she was crazy, that, you know, I was 600 miles away, she couldn't hear a noise. And I teased her about it, and she still sort of insisted that there was a noise and asked me if I heard it. And I thought she was, you know, I mean, she's a real skeptic, but I thought I teased her quite a bit. But later she called and said there was this huge flap going on, UFO flap. And she was a skeptic. She wasn't a UFO person at all. And she said UFOs were chasing cars and people were keeping their kids in at night. People stayed in at night. And it sounded just like a war zone, the way she described it. And I was in Missouri and I didn't pay attention too much. But later I moved back to Ohio and was working at OSU, Ohio State University. And they had a newspaper room. And one day, just on a whim, I decided to go in and see if I could find anything about that noise. And so I went in this newspaper room, and it was like some vault from some movie or something, Indiana Jones or something. It was huge, and all kinds of newspapers, and I thought, well, I'll never find that. And I guessed at the date and started looking, and I found it real fast, to my surprise, because I didn't think I'd ever find it. And I found a little article about the noise, and I recognized it because I don't think that a noise like that has ever been reported exactly like that. And so anyway, it turned out that this noise was exactly the same time as the Pascagoula abduction. But at that time, I didn't pay too much attention to the abduction or the Pascagoula information or anything. I was just interested in the noise. And it was a huge noise. It went from Iowa to the Atlantic coast and from New York to Tennessee. It was just huge. And as well as I can figure out, I think it, in extent, it's probably the second largest sound ever after the volcanic Krakatoa explosion. I mean, largest recorded noise. And so I started investigating it just for, I don't know why I did, but I did. And just because it was unexplained, for one thing. And I started collecting information from newspapers and things to find out size and other information about it. And I submitted the write-up to a scientific journal, peer-reviewed scientific journal, and a state of Ohio seismologist contacted me, and he was interested. The state of Ohio seismologist, he was a professor in the geology department in USGS and all kinds of things. And he helped me study the sound. And I did report it in the scientific literature, the peer-reviewed scientific literature report. But later, and at that time, they say scientists are, you know, skeptics and debunkers and everything. Well, I had help from several scientists that were quite interested in, of course, I didn't say UFOs or anything, but they were just interested in what would cause a noise that nobody could figure out, you know, where it came from or anything else. And so later, a number of years later, I published it in the MUFON journal, which is a UFO journal. And I got debunked there. Somebody wrote in and said, oh, this was the airplane SR-71 and that flew over that time, and it was that. Well, I kind of weakly debunked my debunker by saying the noise wasn't where the plane was. And
let's talk about that a little more, because the SR-71 happened to be flying at the same time this noise occurred. But have you gotten any analysis of what kind of sonic boom it does make? Because it doesn't sound to me anything like this noise. Am I right about that?
Yeah. The he attributed it to this SR-71, and the SR-71 is probably the only airplane. I mean, they no longer make it, but it was just an astounding airplane. But it could fly at supersonic speed across the country. It could make long flights without refueling, so it would be the logical airplane, you know, to make that sound. But the thing is that its flight, where it flew, was known. The pilots had written it up and said exactly where the plane was. Well, when I had written the article in MUFON, I just said weakly that the sound wasn't where the plane was. And I didn't know that much about it. But after that, NASA published a lot of information about sonic booms and sonic booms of SR-71s and a lot of studies. And so I had a lot more equipment to analyze my data. And I also could find a lot more data because with the internet now, you can go through and find more newspaper articles. And I had just found a few, but I found quite a bit more from that literature search. So I knew where the sound was, and I knew where the airplane was, and I knew how large the a sonic boom would be from an airplane like that. And they didn't match up at all. So I had something real technical to go on that this wasn't from that airplane.
So, the additional data made it clear. And can you describe some of the witness descriptions of this particular sound, which are very different from the double explosion of a sonic boom? And the sonic boom would have been limited to a few miles north and south of the airplane's transcontinental course as well.
Yeah, the airplane that described flew at 80,000 feet, and at that altitude, the sonic boom would be, which was about a mile per 1,000 feet, would be 80 miles or 40 miles on each side.
Right.
And so anyway, where the sonic boom was heard was not where the airplane was. The airplane landed in Rome, New York, and also it flew over New York and a little tiny bit of Pennsylvania and northern Ohio. And there were, like at Rome, New York, there weren't any reports of a sonic boom, even though that's where the airplane went, because it was at 80,000 feet.
Yeah, and I was just going to say, at 80,000 feet, it's not going to project much of a sonic boom because the atmosphere it's in is too thin to create one.
Yeah, so, I mean, where the actual airplane was, there wasn't any evidence of a sonic boom, much at all, because I could look at the newspapers for those cities and nobody reported a sonic boom. There was also an airplane, a person from the Griffiths Air Base, where the airplane landed, and he didn't hear a sonic boom. But the sonic boom was heard far south. It was heard, first of all, in Iowa, and then kind of through the middle of Illinois and Indiana, Ohio, Pennsylvania, and Maryland.
And you mentioned Tennessee as well.
Yeah, it was very wide at the end because there may have been some sound around in the middle of New York and extended all the way down into the Cumberland Valley of Tennessee, and I just picked out Nashville, or let me see, I forget what city, but anyway, it was in the Cumberland Valley, and I could get about 700 miles wide for the thing, although, you know, that's an estimate, but it was a huge, huge noise, and it was way larger than any sonic boom would be.
Especially a sonic boom if one was created by an airplane flying that high. So
if it was,
go ahead.
Yes, I think I calculated if the sonic boom was like 500 miles wide, the airplane would have to be nearly 50 miles high, and that would be in space and it wouldn't make any boom at all. But this was right. making a huge, huge overpressure, such as shattered windows and things besides being that wide. So it just didn't fit the physics
it it was a big sensational event. And yet, what transpired thereafter?
Yeah. The sound seemed to be different because there was one scientist that reported from a seismograph station, and he had heard, sonic booms, regular sonic booms, and compared it to this one. And a regular sonic boom is sort of like rumble or something, kind of like thunder maybe or something. Well, he said this was sharp and not exactly like a sonic boom. And other people had reported this didn't sound like a normal sonic boom. It made newspaper headlines all across the country. That's how I was able to find out its extent in width and length, because I took the newspaper headlines from the next day, because they wouldn't have been contaminated from, a lot of secondary information. So I took a lot of information from the newspapers, and it was reported right across the country. So it was, I don't think any other flight had done anything like that. And there were other flights of the SR-71. And usually they were just heard over a narrow area, and people identified them pretty fast. This was never identified, and it was in a much, it was in an area that was just incompatible with a sonic boom from an SR-71 or anything else.
Well, it must have been something massive because of its intensity. I mean, shattering windows, and you calculated would have had to have been a huge aircraft. So now, before we're going to take another break, Free Dreamlanders, but before I do that, I would like to let our subscribers know that you can now give this wonderful experience of Dreamland and Unknown Country as a gift. All you have to do that is to go into your account, to log in, and then scroll down on under the login subscriber home login to your account, and at the bottom of your account page you will see a gift giving option. Now it's new, and you can give a gift of anything from a 3-month subscription on up, but the beauty of this is you will pay only for the first segment of whatever recurring subscription you give. Then your the person you gave the gift to will be sent a notice saying that if they wish to continue, they can do so on their own. So it's a very nice gift, and I know you're going to enjoy giving it. And the site, as always, benefits the most from your support. When you give a gift to somebody of this website, you're giving them something quite extraordinary, and you're saying to them, you care about them, and you want to give them something very special. Free Dreamlanders, we will be right back. UnknownCountry.com subscribers have access to a vast treasury of information. Listen to what Dr. Robert Schock said. He's an expert on the past, and for that reason, he also knows a great deal about the future.
We are re-entering, as you say, a debris field, and when you have a debris field like this, it enters the solar system, it energizes the solar system. As you have things going into the sun, even clouds of dust particles, for instance, it will energize the sun, it will destabilize the sun. This is what we saw at the end of the last ice age, in approximate terms, about 13,000 years ago.
And just in the past few days, more enormous meteors have been sighted,
And this goes on continuously, more and more every year. We live in a time of great change in a world that doesn't like to look at things as they are. UnknownCountry.com offers extraordinary information, a vast archive that you cannot find anywhere else. Subscribe today. Help keep this website going, because without you, there is and can be no us. Go to UnknownCountry.com right now. Click on the subscribe tab. Get started. We're talking to Irina McCammon Scott. Her website is irinascott.com. Her new book is the absolutely extraordinary Beyond Pascagoula, the rest of the amazing story. And I'm almost tempted to say the amazing story beyond Pascagoula, because the Pascagoula event was only one part of a huge story. Now, there were extraordinary UFO sightings synchronous with the sonic boom, were there not?
Yes, of course, the Pascagoula one, but there were a lot of them from Pascagoula. Pascagoula was south of where the boom was heard, but the boom was heard around the same time. And over the area that the boom was heard, there was also a flap. And for example, I pull out as an example of Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, which is important in UFOs because it's where Project Blue Book took place. It's where there's pretty good evidence that Roswell debris was taken. And it was the lead investigator for UFOs. But there were a number of people that were observing UFOs from Wright-Patterson at that time. I mean, they were amateur people, ufologists, but they were good people. I mean, you know, like other people that became scientists and things. So a lot of people at that same time had reported the boom to Wright-Patterson, and, you know, if official government people were seeing UFOs, they wouldn't have reported it, but there were UFO investigators that were out reporting UFOs around Wright-Patterson, so that was kind of interesting. And Wright-Patterson was taking a lot of calls from all over saying, "What's that boom?" And so was Rickenbacker and a lot of, which is south of Columbus, Ohio, and east of Wright-Patterson, another Air Force base. But newspapers and Air Force bases and military people and everything else were taking all kinds of reports about the boom at that time. And that was the same time as Pascagoula was having a flap. And according to my mother's telephone call then, there was quite a flap going on in Ohio too. So this was, it was some distance from Pascagoula, but it was the same time, so you don't know whether there was some effect or not.
Now there was a, there's a crash involved in this flap. A crackling fireball falls into an area near Lake Erie called Lorain County. Can you tell us about, and then there are suggestions that you mentioned Jenny Randall's 1995 book, UFO Retrievals, The Recover of Alien Spacecraft. And there's a suggestion that these craft were, that there were crashes even.
Went into the subject of big sounds because my because a seismologist I was with was interested in what caused large sounds. And the crash was the Kecksburg crash, which I think was 1965.
Oh, I'm sorry. I misunderstood.
Yeah. that was a different crash. It was kind of, it had some similarities, but that was different. This sound was very unusual because it covered this wide area. And if it covered that wide area, it should have been from something way up in the air that wouldn't cause any sound at all.
Right. Well, what could have caused it? You know, that's a very big question, because the sound happened, and there are booms happening all over the place now. People are constantly reporting these big unexplained booms. In fact, a local event took place here where I live. There have been three of them in the past 6 months, all about the same time at night, and one of them I even managed to pick up on my home surveillance system, and I published on Unknown Country on my YouTube channel. So they are now kind of ubiquitous. They're not as large in general as they were. But what do you think they are? Just, you know, because something huge would have had to have made that noise.
Well, what was really strange about it was it at the height that you could calculate from the width of the sound, it should have been way up in the air. And in such an instance, there wouldn't be any overpressure or anything. But what was strange was that across three states, it was shattering windows. And so the physics of it just made no sense at all in terms of sonic boom.
Exactly. It wasn't a sonic boom, because you couldn't have a sonic boom over an area that widespread without the plane being essentially in outer space. And then it wouldn't have created a sonic boom.
And that's, so I had enough data to do calculations on it, and it showed up on two seismographs, which is quite strange for, I mean, if you have a real low airplane going over, it might get picked up by a seismograph, but this was picked up on two seismographs. They were some distance apart. And so with that time, I could calculate the speed, and it was about 2.9 times the time the speed of sound. And so anyway, the scientists in the paper, well, at first they thought it was the sonic boom from this airplane that caused it, and people jumped on the pilots when they landed. But then by the next day, scientists looked at the data and said, no, that's way too big for, you know, that airplane, and the airplane wasn't where the boom was too. And so they explained it as a earth grazing meteor, or they tried to explain it as a meteor, and there wasn't any evidence of the meteor landing or anything. There was just, there were windows being broken and everything, but nobody saw a meteor come down. And so so I could calculate the speed, and a meteor, an earth grazing meteor, has to go faster than Earth's escape velocity, which would be about 35 times the speed of sound. And so this was much, much slower than a meteor. So it wasn't, you know, mathematically, there's no evidence it was an earth-grazing meteor, such as the scientists seem to try to explain it.
Explain it away, rather. You know, nice thing about having you on a case like this, Irina, is you can do the science and the math, and most of us can't. And so you, when you speak about something like this, you speak with authority. I'm going to ask you to speculate. We know it was something very unusual, and it was happening during a UFO flap. What is your thought? And I'm, you know, I understand that you're very science oriented and very fact oriented, and that's one of the great things about your work, but in your mind, and when you think about this, what do you think might have been happening? Because after all, there was an extraordinary abduction, and then this enormous UFO flap. Give us a sort of a big picture idea. You must have thought about this?
Well, my thoughts were, is that this took a lot of energy to go. I compared it to one of those meteors that landed in, that broke apart in Russia, that I think, I forget what, there were a lot of pictures from people's autos and things. And I roughly calculated that probably there was more energy in it than that, which I think was about 500,000 tons of TNT or something. Well, I mean, this was a very rough calculation. But what was interesting was is that I had enough data to do good calculations on its speed and things. And I couldn't, I just went other than the two seismographs, I just went by when it was reported in the newspaper, so that was not as accurate for its speed. But it might have, it possibly changed speed during the time that that it was detected. It went from about EST, about 820 EST to before 9, and across the country. And it looked like if I could, I suppose I could have drawn a regression line through it to see where approximately the object was, but it looked like it might have been very slightly curved. I couldn't quite tell, but it looked like it was on the west end. It seemed to be higher in latitude than Chicago, but as it came down through Illinois, it didn't seem to be detected in Chicago. And then as it crossed the country, it seemed to become wider, and toward the end it was detected in areas of New York, and as I said, clear down to the Cumberland Valley. And so I couldn't quite tell if it was linear or not. It might have been slightly curved, and the object might have changed its speed, which isn't quite like what a meteor would do. So I think that and it didn't fit a meteor, the physics of a meteor or an airplane. And so I don't know. I speculated that maybe some kind of a UFO type thing happened at that time because of the flap and everything, and maybe this had an influence over all the sightings and things, but the actual sound seemed pretty mysterious, and it became more mysterious as I had more data.
The question of what caused the sound, we have a situation, there's an abduction. The sound takes place, is it before the abduction or after?
They didn't, they didn't have watches on them, so they didn't know exactly when the abduction.
No, but was it the same, was it an earlier night or the same night?
It was the same night.
The same
night.
And
I know what, yeah.
And I think that's quite important because, after all, I mean, you have this bizarre sound, not a meteor, not a plane, and then on the same night, maybe before, maybe after, maybe we don't know, two people end up inside a UFO. And so what are we to think? It would seem to me that there is a connection of some kind between the two. And, you know, we're going to go a little bit more into your experience of knowing Calvin as well as you do in the last half hour of the show. But before we go there, I want to talk about UFO flaps more in general. And what I would like to do is to discuss the various theories about what caused these flaps, because they do happen. We may actually be in one right now, or in the beginning of one, because there seem to be so many UFO sightings being recorded, and I haven't done enough analysis yet to determine whether or not it's simply that people are getting better at it. We have many more cameras and so forth than we had in the past, or that there really is an uptick. Now, before we go there, though, free Dreamlanders, enjoy these commercials. And subscribers, don't forget, all you have to do to give Unknown Country, Dreamland, and all of our wonderful material as a gift is to enter your own account, scroll down to the bottom, and click on the gift tag and keep it, and take it from there. We'll be right back. Where is the Unknown Country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown Country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. UnknownCountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. We're talking to Irina Scott. Her new book, Beyond Pascagoula. Way beyond Pascagoula. It is really something. Now, I want to go into UFO waves. You have a number of theories, the Martian hypothesis, the tourist theory, all kinds of different theories about what may this be. And now a new theory, a monitor from another solar system. I think I'd rather than go through a list, I think I'd rather let you just discuss these theories kind of in general, if you will. But let's start out with the Martian hypothesis, which I know has been around for quite a while.
Well, some people wrote a paper in a journal on flaps and waves. And I think the general idea is that a flap occurs when people hear of other people giving a UFO report, so then suddenly everybody gives a UFO report. Well, these people studied it, and that wasn't it. They seemed to not be related to anything. For example, one of the early theories was that when Mars was close to Earth, that there were flaps, but that didn't turn out at all because later Mars was close and there weren't flaps, so that didn't iron out at all. There were other ones, and ones that times you might expect a flap, such as when E.T. the movie came out and several other things, you'd expect a flap, but there weren't any. And when the Russians sent up the first satellite, the Sputnik, well, everybody was out watching and everything, but there wasn't a UFO flap. And so they didn't, the UFO flaps didn't seem to be related to anything expected. They just seemed to be something that happened once in a while. And now it's hard to collect data, or there may not even be any flaps. But I was recently, that extrasolar object came through that I think it's called a Muamua or something, came through that they calculated didn't belong to our solar system. It just zapped through our solar system back out. And probably other things had happened at other times, but nobody had the math to calculate them before. And I was speculating that maybe something like that was related to this, because maybe something was monitoring us for a while. It was several months and then left, because this flap seemed a little different from the rest of them. It seemed a lot larger. But, for example, the Pascagoula abduction, the beings seemed to be different. And there were a lot of other things that seemed different, such as one thing I noticed was the color blue. There were a lot of reports of UFOs connected with the color blue. Well, the color blue is not an aircraft color. I mean, airplanes have red and green lights on their wings and a white strobe light, landing lights and stuff, but not blue. And meteors aren't blue. But there were quite a number of reports of blue objects, which kind of stood out, because this would not be normal air traffic. I mean, in this flap. And there were a number of other things, such as, like one woman reported that two of her cows were killed, and another woman reported that she had a cat in her car with all the windows up and everything, and this UFO came close, and the cat disappeared. But, of course, cats can really squirm around, too, but she didn't know how it got out.
But it's actually a very strange story, because the cat was in a closed car and just disappeared. Yeah, and was never found again. Is that correct?
Yeah. It wasn't squirreled away in the car anyplace.
Yeah. So it just disappeared. And now the cattle, those were not classic cattle mutilations, were they? What were the features of the cattle?
I don't think they got too much information. Some woman called and reported that the UFO landed and two of her cows were killed. But I didn't find any more information about it. No, apparently nobody investigated more on that. But there were several such reports of cattle being killed. And so, you know, it might have been similar to cattle mutilations, which were reported later.
You know, you made a point earlier that the UFO flaps are not, they're not really identifiable anymore. And the reason being that there are so many UFOs around now. You just see them, people report them all the time. And that's been true since long before 2017. It's been true for at least 10 or 15 years or more that, you know, people, it used to be that seeing a UFO was an extraordinary and unusual event. Now something like 30% of the population has seen a UFO. Could it be that this is not exactly, that someone is trying to acclimatize us to their presence? And if so, then what happens when we find out that, you know, animals or people can disappear in an instant, cattle mutilations are taking place, harsh, strange abductions. It's a very strange period to be living in, I think. And what do you think the future of it is, in the sense that could it be that we're going to get to a point very soon where we know for sure that this is here and this is not of known origin?
Well, I think that sound was a pretty good instance of, they say, you know, UFOs are ephemeral and you can't get any scientific data on it. Well, I think that's why I was concentrating on that sound, is because there was data, but it didn't agree with the normal theories of sound. But a difference between then and now is that when Project Blue Book was going on, there wasn't the internet, there weren't computers, there weren't cell phones, everybody wasn't walking around with a phone. And so also there was a huge amount of harassment. So people, even if they saw something, they didn't report it. And even if they did have a way to report it, most people probably didn't. But there was one place to report it to, so you could still get consistent data. Now there's all kinds of places to report it to. And everybody's walking around with a cell phone and everything. You probably get more reports, plus the government and the officials finally are looking at it a little bit differently due to the military aspects of the Coast Guard and the Nimitz and Princeton and Hornet aircraft and radar and stuff.
Right.
So I think that's what caused it to be taken seriously, is that they actually had a government study that was taking it seriously, and that was the AATIP, the ATIP study, which was going on in the DIA. And it was secret for a while, but Lorenzo reported it. And that's helped a lot to, because finally the government admitted that there's things flying around that they don't understand. And
yes, that's right. They did finally. And now also the Director of National Intelligence has suggested that there may be an alien presence here. Very subtly, she didn't come out and say that, but she said, she mentioned the word extraterrestrial origin here, so, which is a beginning. And I think that we'll probably over the next year or two, we're going to become much more comfortable with the fact that this exists. But as you and I have talked about earlier in the show, it's going to be very hard on people when they begin to realize how tough it is. And we can talk, we're going to talk now in the third half hour about the Pascagoula incident and what the two witnesses went through and the other witnesses that have come forward to the incident. It turns out to be, at first it seemed just two men claiming something. It turns out to have been rather extensively witnessed on many different levels. So, free Dreamlanders, I would thank you as always for being with us on Dreamland. And subscribers, remember, you can enter your account, scroll down to the bottom, and give Unknown Country as a very lovely gift.
You've been listening to